We'll bring the meeting to order at 7:02. Start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Erica, would you roll, please?
Present.
Here.
Here.
Here. Haven't heard from Jim. Hopefully he'll show up. Open the floor to public comment if there's any. Okay. Agenda is approval of May 14th minutes. There really aren't. It was a non-meeting. You did take minutes though, right, Erica? So we can just kind of approve those at the next. They're not official, but just give you an idea of what we gabbed about there. Well, moving right along. See, Val, we'll be out of here. Mike Provo, you have a River Walk Committee or Waterfront?
Yes. Mike Provo, 16 Beach Street. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Riverwalk Committee. We were here back in April to talk about the improvements to Water Street and the gateway down to the waterfront. And we did go back to the engineers and ask for the suggested changes that we had talked about that night, which was to have the granite curbing around the outside edge of the park, to remove the pavers that were in the center of the park and the parking lot going down to the walkway and put them on the side so that the sidewalk would come down the side. However, we do not have a final plan because they would have charged us to redo the plans before we were ready for the final plan. So what I'm basically here tonight is to answer the questions that yes, we can use those pavers that were in the center. And at the sidewalk, there was a question as to how wide it would be, and it would be the standard width, which is a minimum of 5 feet. So it would extend only 5 feet into the park. So I think it would actually be less pavement than what you have in the park, because that center walkway is actually a little bit wider than what the sidewalk would be going down the edge there. We would be, it's also going to be built out separately within it, so that we'll know how much it was to do that work. Where you were going to be partnering with us on it. So it'll all be in the same bill, but it'll just be itemized separately for what it is they're doing for the for the moving the pavers and the looming and stuff like that. So, So basically it's an update and hoping, you know, that we're still on the same page and everything with that. They're looking at going out to bid, I know. So,
so we don't have any idea on costs?
We don't have any idea on the cost yet. We have a Riverwalk meeting next week so that I could communicate that to you after the Riverwalk meeting. But regardless of what the actual cost is, it is in the process now. So whatever the Conservation Commission would have towards it, you know, the Riverwalk budget would pick up the rest if it exceeded that cost. So.
We were all here for that meeting, correct?
Yes. I mean, I have a picture here, but it's just the small one because I gave the big drawings back to Diane, but I had supplied everyone with a drawing that night, so.
I think our last motion that was, it was a condition for Mike to come back.
Right, it was to come back, and there were questions on the width of the sidewalk and whether or not they would use the same pavers so that they would match. So right. We have done that. That is all in the plan. So I'm back here to say that. And I guess I'm sort of looking for final go-ahead from the Conservation Commission.
That was in April.
So when it goes
right?
out to bid, that was in April.
I just want to check to see did we mention dollar amount to donate to the or to partner with them?
No.
No, you had mentioned that you had some funds in the Shanda Park account that could go towards it, so, and...
You were just looking for final approval once the plans had been drawn up.
Right, and the thing is we didn't want to spend $3,000 or $4,000 having the plans drawn up at this point in time, because that was money that we could spend in doing the project, so...
I think we were all on board with the concept.
Yes, we were.
Mm-hmm, yep.
It's a good project to do, to be partners with.
And we are trying to get it done this summer. There was some elevations that were a little bit wrong that the engineers were looking at that set us back a little bit, so, but we'll know more. Unfortunately, the Riverwalk meeting is next week and not this week before this one, so. The way things hit, so.
Do we need a motion, should we have a motion to expend some dollars now?
I think you should have a motion to authorize the modification of the park.
To go ahead and with the modifications of the park.
No, we only approved the concept.
We only looked at the concept.
Right, because I was supposed to come back when we had the questions.
Can we do that tonight?
I think we can, there's four of us here.
Yep.
I don't see a problem with that. So if you want a word of motion.
I make a motion to authorize the Riverwalk Committee to relocate the northern sidewalk from within Shanda Park to the...
Edge of Water Street.
Edge of Water Street, thank you.
And then re-loom and reseed the old paved area.
Yes, subject with the condition that the area disturbed shall be re-loomed and seeded.
Second it.
Cover it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Passed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
We will be notifying you as soon as we know what the actual amount is.
Right.
Which I should know next Wednesday. And timing. Yeah, as soon as... Julie will be taking sort of charge of this along with the downtown project, because I think they were looking at having Severino do the work.
Is someone coordinating with Diane Hardy on the shoreline exemption for the urban zone before any work gets done there? Newmarket, we're not exempt. We've never filed.
Right, and I had mentioned that they should file because we went through that in Dover. She's on the Riverwalk Committee, so she's aware of what's going on. So I would dare say that this is all being taken care of as part of the process. But thanks for bringing it up.
As long as the committee's aware of it.
Yep. I will make a note of that while I'm here, just to make sure that we're getting all the permits. I know that, because they're also working with Fish and Game on the boat launch and everything else down there. So there's a lot going on.
Very good.
But you don't know if it'll be done by Heritage, huh?
Our intention is to have it done by Heritage. And from what I understand... Right, and from what I understand, the project itself does not take that long, and we are now back on track with the project to be going out for the bids. So...
Great.
Good.
But I don't know definitely until a meeting next Wednesday, and I'll convey that to Bruce as soon as... I find the information, he can get it out to the rest of the board.
Wednesday meeting?
Wednesday meeting.
Here?
Here, downstairs.
Time?
Is it Wednesday or is it Tuesday? I'll have to get back to you on that.
Just call me and leave a message.
Yeah, because I have two meetings next week, and I'll probably confuse which one is TIF and which one is... I know they're both at 7 and they're both downstairs.
7 downstairs. I'm writing it down. Hopefully I can make it.
I believe it's a Tuesday meeting.
Tuesday?
Yeah.
Let me know for sure.
Wednesday is the TIF. Thursday is the TIF. So, yeah, it's Tuesday.
Okay,
definitely.
Great.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. The next thing is not on the agenda because Sergio was a little behind in calling. Has to do with the Hickory Pond
for the wetlands permit.
For the what? Is it the wetlands permit or?
Wetlands permit at this point.
Does that require public notice? Not notice to a butters, but public notice on our agenda?
It's not a public hearing like the, it's open for public comment.
Right, but it hasn't been noticed.
They've been notified.
I'm just looking at our agenda, which is the public notice. And I don't have my RSAs here.
And I don't either. The butters would notify?
No, not the, I know,
I'm just going through.
The issue of public notice that it's being spoken about at this meeting.
Yeah, I understand.
Sergio, I'm going to let you go through this, but I'm going to have to do a little research, and you may have to do this again. So.
Should have been on the agenda.
Looking for approval?
Just like the planning board comment and approve, and, you know, with the goal of recommending favorable support from you, that the, it's like.
Similar to what we did on.
For planning board, yeah, for the mitigation component.
Yeah, I would just say that I would hate it if you would have to come back and do this all over again because it wasn't noticed properly. It's not on our agenda, so therefore it wasn't posted. That there was a public hearing.
I see what you're saying. If they were notified, I understand that they were, but all butters were notified.
Notified, but not of the meeting.
Yeah.
Can I see the application?
There you go.
So would you have objection presenting it now and coming back at the next meeting after it's properly presented on the agenda? Or would you rather hold off?
I'd probably rather hold off so I could, if there were any issues to abutters that would be maybe probably post, you know, possibly the same abutters that would have been at last Tuesday's meeting, might have additional.
There were a few abutters at the planning board meeting for the first time on this Tuesday. So it might be wise to do that.
And I'm only, I don't know the answer to the question. I'm only bringing it up.
I'm not sure either.
I just know that it's not for.
Whether or not it requires to be on an agenda item. So that there is public notice.
We're all together. I don't know the answer to that either.
That's why I say if, you're welcome to do it now.
I think the requirement is the notification of abutters. I know that for the RSAs, that the RSA 43.
And you have that, I saw that in a table of contents.
Yeah,
that you
and there's
do have
all my receipts are in there as well.
But the question becomes, and then it's the town's responsibility too. You're notifying the abutters, but is it, does the town have a responsibility to notify the hearing?
I don't know. The town, I'm not sure. It might differ out, but I'm not certain on that. But the next meeting would be when? July, right?
Right. The only thing about that, Val, is that we're not a.
It's not like.
We're just here to give comments.
Comments.
Yeah.
We're
yeah.
here for
your
comments. And.
You either.
We don't actually sign any approvals.
I mean, I have no objection if Sergio wants to move forward.
I think we can do this.
I would like to present it. You're all very familiar with it, and as you did, Val, for the planning board, have a favorable letter of favorable recommendation for the issuance of the permit to the Wetlands Bureau.
Do you want to lay these out?
And you're okay that if we find out that. Because that if there was a requirement that we as a commission had to issue a public notice by being on our agenda and posting in the two places, you're okay with having to, if you have to come back to do it again.
Well, the only thing, the only issue I would have is you might have to, if you made a favorable recommendation, without, if you find out later that was needed, you'd still, I'd still have to wait for a letter to be written to the state till after said meeting. And at that point, whether my presence would need to be here, it could be discussed between the commission and the public. That you know, I don't, I'm not sure.
Still might want to come if yeah. that's required. I think yeah. you should still be here to answer questions. But I gut feeling is I think we're all set to do it tonight.
Great.
We do just give a memo back to. Planning board. Mm-hmm. I think we're within our.
Well, it would be a memo to the state at this point.
And the state.
Well, the planning board has already, Val has written that favorable. The May 28th letter? Use, yeah, for the special use permit. Yeah. Yeah. I'm not sure of the answer to that either. And, you know, if I had to come back for an hour, I don't know if it would be. An issue, but I can't speak for my client's own piggy bank. I'm here. I've, you know, I stayed across the street till 7 tonight. So,
I mean, I say let's do it, but I just want to make sure that you're on. You know, that
if we go through it quickly and it's all right, and if it comes up later that you and Bruce correspond and find out that we actually had to have that. Then that's fine. But we've been through this before, I think, for other projects yeah. where it's been I've been late.
But it's usually on the agenda.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to suggest we do it and get it done with, and I'll check Monday
and
since
get,
the
and get back
town
to
hall
me.
Is closed. Tomorrow I'll check with Ed Monday.
Okay.
And
if that's a motion, I'll second it.
No, it's not a motion. Okay. I don't know that we. I think it's up to Sergio that, like he said, he has got a client that is paying his time.
Yep.
I wouldn't suspect it would be more than what tonight would be. You're all very familiar with the project, and I could bring anybody in the public up to speed.
Black book over there in the corner is there.
Here, I'd like to present it and hopefully get a favorable recommendation if it turns out we needed to actually have public notice on the agenda, then I can take the heat for it. That's what's going to happen.
So, Joe, do you need?
I've got some.
You got yours? Yeah. Okay. These will go in the file.
You have to step down because you're in a butter. Is that right?
I probably will step back for that. Yeah, I think that would be right. We still have 3 out of 5, so I think we're all set there. So I won't be voting on the approvals or anything like that where I'm direct a butter for that. Okay. I think that's enough notice for that, right? So if you want to start.
Okay, for the record, Sergio Bonilla, wetland scientist with NHSC, here on behalf of Hickory Pond Partners again for my third time in front of you now to present the dredge and fill application, which is somewhat the same, speaks to only wetland, direct wetland impacts rather than buffer zone impacts and any mitigation proposal or component that was presented on behalf of the special use permit for the planning board. What we have here is, as you know, a subdivision, a proposal for a six-lot subdivision on approximately a 15-acre site on the corners of Swamp, Ash Swamp Road and Grant Road in Newmarket, situated between all residential homes. The subdivision itself is six lots and requires a wetland crossing to access the buildable uplands. The total wetland impact proposed is 2,200 square feet, located on at the thinnest and least impacting location to provide that access to the uplands. It's a pedestrian forested wetland system that, as I most recently checked, is all drawn down at this point, and the vernal pool directly to the south, to the southwest has, or southeast has, at this point, has dried down, has the water has drawn down in there, as vernal pools usually do. At any rate, the wetland crossing will consist of a through road and two 18-inch plastic PVC pipes, well, not PVC pipes, plastic HDP pipes, to maintain any hydrologic connection there at the crossing during seasons of high water in the early spring and perhaps in the late fall time period. I've been corresponding with Fish and Game throughout the whole process. They had a couple concerns with regard to curbing, as you know, probably Val, and some of you might know, is that there's no curbing proposed. Road runoff would be directly treated directly through swales and through other natural filter strips and level spreaders and such, and the detention area in the middle of the cul-de-sac. The only area that does have some Cape Cod berm, which is what the, for the record, was what the Fish and Game did recommend, if any curbing was there, that it be composed of Cape Cod slanted curbing to facilitate travel for herb tiles. So, as I said, in that vein, there's a short road station from 0.04 to 1.5 road station at the beginning, where there's that length of roadway is Cape Cod berming. All the rest is, as I've previously mentioned, all road runoff will be treated by swales and catchments and such. I'll be corresponding with the Corps of Engineers who will be involved in the federal view at the state level through the secondary impacts checklist, and hopefully they will concur. Moreover, they Mark Kern will probably be happy that he sees the mitigation component around that vernal pool, which is the basis of that component through the town planning board and through current Army Corps of Engineer requirements or recommendations for vernal pools. The approximate locations of the houses they're approximate, but generally fall within, or definitely fall within, specifically fall within building envelopes, which are setbacks from the most restrictive buffer, along with their septic 4K areas. They'll all be compliant with frontage and with land requirements for their septic systems. And as you know, this has nothing to do with the state review, but as you know, we've got upwards of 7 acres of mitigation for buffer, additional buffer areas and additional protection around the vernal pool as our pitch for the local level, and also as a supplemental pitch for the state in Hampshire.
All of these striped areas are the additional protected area. Am I correct?
I didn't point that out. The striped areas for the purpose of this application is the wetland areas, and the highlighted area is the crossing of the impact area. I've also got the mitigation plan under there, which shows you again the mitigation component with the deed restricted areas.
Okay, so that's not the extra protected land, that's striped now.
No, I'm sorry, I should have pointed that out first and foremost.
This application is only for the crossing, correct?
Only for the crossing, it has nothing to do with, it doesn't require mitigation at the state level, mitigation was required locally, so we could try to, you know, pitch that to the state, but they really don't, you know, it'd be nice for the Corps to know that, but it's not really something that the state looks for unless you exceed 10,000 square feet of impact. Mitigation is not required, but the Fish and Game would appreciated this in our correspondence at the state, and I'm sure it would be looked upon favorably by the state, but they really can't make their judgments based on or
okay, the road base it. That goes across the wetland right there, the impacted area, will that have any curbing at all?
No. It probably will have
further down.
The only curbing area is located right here at the frontage. The road frontage area. About here to about 1 + 50, which is right about here. Let's see if it goes here. During infrastructure installation and construction, all you know, customary BMPs and any temporary sedimentation measures will be adhered to. I know that it was discussed at the local level that they would like to have some sort of monitoring. I'm not sure what was precipitated out of that, Valerie, but Adele mentioned to me that was something that was brought up at the special use permit application hearing. So that's the gist of it. 2,200 square feet of impact to access 15 acres, seven of which will be built upon, roughly there.
Sergio, can you comment on, just kind of looking through the application, on the threatened and endangered species that have been listed as potentially being present there?
To clarify that, yeah, that's a good one to bring up. The NHB report, has record, records of landing sternal locations up to the north, and some spotted turtle records located to the south, maybe closer to the Piscassic. So what they were concerned about was mortality because of barricades to movement, which was straight granite curbing. So they recommended, as I said before, that we use, if anything, sloped curbing. Also, it was tufted loosestrife that was loosestrife located up closer to the open palustrine scrub wetlands, and like I said, Blanding's turtle. What else did we have? Here's the map. Do you have the map in front of you, Val? Fen ant, which is something that was located records up to the north beyond Newmarket Plains, up by Tuttle Swamp, and again the spotted turtles. I'm sorry, I was wrong. It's to the northwest, up by the cemetery, the wetlands behind the cemetery, and Blandings. Where's Blandings?
So, were there any identified on site?
None, no, but they have the, you know, the opportunity to comment with upon, because there's wetlands.
It could, yeah, that
where there could provide some barricades, where they're up to the north or down to the south, they've got home ranges, so they just wanted to speak to that and make sure that we would implement any measures that might sort of offset or mitigate, or not even mitigate, that would prevent any taking of those critters. Blanding's turtle, I can't find on the map. It's just listed there. It's not even located anywhere near our map that they provide to us, but at any rate, it's been noted in and around the area. 5 years ago, radio tracked up by like I said, the vegetated scrub shrub wetlands in and about toward the Lamprey, the western portion of the Lamprey River,
Yeah, I don't see a map included.
Yeah, but they, yeah, they're not mapped on the map that they provide to us, but they, you know, it's out of consideration.
They're not on the site.
No, they're nothing on the site directly, but they do have concerns about home range and travel and anything that might disrupt their travel within a home range. So as I said, I followed up with both Kim Tuttle at Fish and Game and Melissa Coppola with regard to tufted loosestrife. She had no comment except that she recommended that there was a hydrologic connectivity would be maintained there. And I made the mistake of sending an overall site plan rather than a site plan that had this close-up of the wetland impact, which depicted the engineered structures that would be there to maintain the flow.
Isn't purple loosestrife a...
Tufted loosestrife, it's a different one.
Oh, okay.
Nicer. Yeah, a little nicer. Right. There's tufted loosestrife, there's world loosestrife is a lot nicer. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, it's not aggressive, exotic, or invasive in any way. There's a couple nice loosestrifes out there, and they're not all bad.
Okay.
The size of the culverts, are they...
218s.
218s.
218 inches.
And does that, do you compare that to any... can you compare that to recent storms, how much that will handle?
What I can say is that the 218 that went through planning board review went through TRC, and Christian Smith, the engineer of the project, had verified all the engineered crossing or the engineered crossing with DPW to make sure that that would maintain the any storms of the 225 and 50 or 210 and 25 at the Grant Road culvert, and he concurred and he was happy with that. What I can say, and you probably see in the field when you walk the site again if you do, is that there is sort of a topographical break just beyond the vernal pool that we located, about 10 or 20 feet. I don't really have my scale. At any rate, at some point, late May, June, right now, I assume that there was complete drawdown. I think I went out there last week, there was complete drawdown a week or two before that. But at any rate, just beyond here, you see it. Right there, you can sort of see where we have two of the the 114 on this side. So we've got a break right there. Any separation during any storm, any storms would either flow. This catchment would flow towards the Grant Road, which is why he followed through with the DPW. I'm not sure whose name. Do you know about the gentleman that approved?
No, but the town engineer actually, Tobin, reviewed all the drainage analysis and calculations, and they were satisfied with the proposed.
Plenty adequate.
Sorry. That's okay.
But Christian didn't know in his, what I do is I provide in the dredge and fill application the executive summary of the drainage calculations for the state's information and review to facilitate their review from an engineering standpoint.
Wynn, you have any questions?
Nope.
Do you know where they're proposing to store all the excavator material and how they're going to create some kind of buffer so there's no runoff if you get into some high rains back into
as far
rain.
As stockpiles and that would be covered. I think that would be covered. Obviously there would be some sort of a SWIP drawn up because we have greater than an acre of disturbance, so there'll be a stormwater management or stormwater pollution prevention plan that would have to be adhered to, and that SWIP, I don't know who would do it. We do them. Christian Smith and Beals, they do them. I'm sure Tobin has done plenty of them. That's the kind of thing that's addressed, phasing, temporary measures, permanent measures, erosion control measures. I can't speak exactly for the phasing of the project and where they would, but there'd probably be some sort of a setback from where stockpiles of a certain pitch could be stored.
On this particular application, does it specify, or will DES... in the permit.
DES has a set of general conditions. Yeah, they will have a set of general conditions, and then if and when they bring that up, they will specify where they'd like to see storage. There's not a site-specific permit required, but they would definitely catch it. So I think in light of the site-specific permit, or the alteration of terrain is what it's called now, permit, or the lack thereof, that DES, Dory Wigan, I'm sure, will be on top of me for that, to make sure that we do it in the proper manner. We've got inspection, maintenance schedule, temporary erosion controls, construction sequence. Excavate and stockpile topsoil loam. All disturbed areas shall be stabilized immediately after grading. And temporary, I know as a company that we recommend per CGP EPA construction general permit requirements that any stockpiles that are left inactive for more than 2 weeks have to be stabilized vegetatively. But as far as if they've, Christian would have, would probably, you know, when he does, if and when he does, a SWIP is developed, that's where that will be spoken to.
Fred?
I'm all set.
But there's some pretty good information in the, in an executive summary, not directly related to, you know, directly specified to stockpiles, but filter strips, dust control, stabilized construction entrance, sequencing, temporary and permanent erosion control measures. So that's the goal. The goal tonight is to hopefully, you know, this is the third time I've been in front of you to obviously get some sort of a favorable recommendation for the approval to the state, of the permit to the state. Knowing what you know.
Do we normally just, we don't need a motion on this, we need,
I think what Sergio needs for his application is comments from the Conservation Commission on the application to that are forwarded from the commission to DES.
What we normally do is they take a motion to write a favorable or a letter with favorable comments. If you didn't have, if you had, you know, several unfavorable comments, we'd probably come back to you with you know, addressing any, if any, issues you'd had at this point, knowing what you've been through.
We've gone over it. We've done a site. We've done a site walk. Maybe I think
the issue, Bruce, is that this is a specific application relative to this crossing and how they are proposing to install the crossing and the measures that they're planning to take from an environmental perspective on erosion control and sedimentation control, things of that nature, which is all documented in the report that was submitted.
Yeah, I had a few minutes today to go over it, but right.
It's usually customary and standard to have everything installed prior to any activity. If there's some clearing that needs to be done prior to installing, you know, customary erosion controls or any temporary measures that might be needed in low-lying areas or in areas that have a greater, you know, square footage of watershed that might shed there.
Will there be reseeding in that area too?
Yeah, any exposed soils throughout, during, and once they're finished, any construction activity or vehicular traffic will be stabilized. That's customary, and you know, when you reach final stabilization at certain points where you know you're not going to have any more substantial activity, you can, up to the contractor or to the discretion of the planning board or anyone that's local or abutters, they like to see that stuff, the erosion control barriers removed, and I'm sure that some of the agencies like Fish and Game would appreciate that too, because then that again,
that's gonna,
it's a barrier at some point.
Create a barrier itself.
Yeah.
But aren't they left in place until this everything is
usually well, until you've got full stabilization.
Right.
And if it's phased out correctly, it works out to have areas completely free while other areas are being worked.
My only comment is, I think just as a matter of policy, that we're being asked to give comments relative to the presentation versus the application, because, you know, I've taken probably 2 minutes skimming through and also trying to listen to you speak, but without having the opportunity to really have read the application. And then, so we can comment on your presentation, but I don't know if that's consistent with the application. I think it's unfair to ask commission members to write a report to DES on an application without having the opportunity to sit down and read that application. I mean, that's just my opinion. And you gave a very good presentation, and I'm familiar with the project.
I speak...
Well, you and I are familiar with the project, but I don't think George and Fred are...
I'm familiar with the project, but, I mean, relative, I mean, this is kind of separate. I mean, this is really
the
wetland crossing
application
for DES. It's really a separate issue from what we've been dealing with on the planning board.
Yeah. It's for the wetland impacts itself. It doesn't really have to do with lot sizing or configuration. It's the direct wetland impacts to seek approval for those impacts.
On other ones, I've noticed that they've had layouts of the where the construction was going to take place, how it was going to be graded off, seeded, and actual maintenance also.
That's what the executive summary speaks to, and all of our 20 questions that we answer, we have to, within the required questions, we have to speak to those issues. And that's stuff, you know, that can be reviewed, I don't know, I submitted it Monday, the application. So this, that kind of stuff can be reviewed and I can discuss it more.
Mm-hmm.
But my presentation is, I've become pretty intimate with this project, so pretty much going.
Well, I think Val has a valid point with timing. I think we need...
Well, I think it goes back to what came up in the last wetlands application that came before us, is that, like on the planning board, we have a technical review committee.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a committee that becomes intimately familiar with the, all of the details of the application, and the committee can report to the board on what those details are. And the board as a whole is also has the benefit, obviously, of listening to the applicant do their presentation. We did talk about it in one of the prior wetlands applications that came before us. You know, that we really shouldn't be, for lack of a better term, rubber stamping applications with giving, a supporting letter to DES without reading them.
Right. We haven't really had time, so. You're pretty much in control of this part of it because of the, I'm stepping down from that, but our part, I think, is to go through this and read it, make sure we understand it.
Yeah.
Timing-wise, it shouldn't be a problem to do this letter at the next meeting, correct? That'll give us each time to go through and read this. Look through the map. If you have questions, then we can ask Sergio at the next meeting.
Because it's not expedited. So how long,
No, you don't have to make a decision tonight
when we get back to DES.
Yeah, they've got 60 days.
Okay.
They have 60 days?
75 now, actually. Now it's 75, I believe.
So I think what I would recommend is that we circulate the application amongst the voting members, and that at our next meeting that we would basically kind of circulate our comments and come to a conclusion for what our letter to DES would be.
And it makes sense to me.
And we can include Sergio at the next meeting. And Val, do you want to be the first one? I was just going to say you can initial the a little note here when you're done with it. Make a call to me or Fred or George and get it to them. And I just ask you guys to do it. Try to get it done, keep it for 2 or 3 days tops, and then get it back I'll be the last one, if it would be.
Sergio, this certainly isn't meant to question your presentation. I just think that we have a responsibility to do that due diligence.
Before you recommend it, yeah. I understand. I mean, it basically, what preempted this in the beginning when we said, we can find out for sure about the actual public notice. And it might be different from town to town. I excuse my ignorance on that.
Well, no, it's
I know that my requirements to
not knowing.
Package with the certified mail receipts.
So Val, I'm going to give this to you first. And then if you could just, between George and Fred, figure that out. Monday.
No, Jim should get it.
And yeah, Jim also. Just initial it after you've read it and pass it on to the next person.
So there's only five of us on this board now?
Well, we have an application in front of us tonight.
We should have voted on that first.
Maybe we should have. Well, actually, once we vote on it, I think it has to be approved by the town council.
The council.
It probably wouldn't make any difference tonight.
For this?
No, for new.
We still want to end review it.
I wish it could, because there is elections of officers tonight.
Well, again, I appreciate your time. Hopefully, we can put this to rest at the next meeting.
So, do you have a card handy that so that I can call you?
Yeah.
I'll put it with my note for Monday, and
it's exactly the same plan the same set of plans that was presented to the with the special use permit application.
Thank you.
That was an easy one, Sergio. We were just trying to figure out which wetland was more important on that application.
Oh.
Because that's all that related to.
Yeah, well, you know which wetland now, right?
Vernal pools.
Well, the bottom line was they were both equally important.
Just different.
Different.
So we felt that. But they were both more important than the crossing.
Yeah, I mean again, look at the application. It's dry as a bone. I mean, it's the narrowest area, which is what DES likes to see: avoidance, minimization, and mitigation. If you exceed, so.
And so, not to duplicate efforts, I think under our wetlands ordinance, the. Planning board also requires comments from the Conservation Commission on wetlands crossings. So I think that our comments should go, it's not a response only to DES, but we will forward
to the
planning board like we did with the special use permit.
Address it to the state, but copy. You mean it would be addressed to the state, to Ms. Wiggin?
Yeah, there's two separate issues, because you have the state DES permitting,
yeah,
and you have the wetlands ordinance.
Have you, has anybody at the planning board, has there been a formal response? I know that it was just Tuesday night, the voting was to approve and to accept and approve the...
I don't know that.
I'm sure someone at the planning board will issue the approval to Hickory Pond. And that's something we'll have in our records to also ensure the state that it's been through the loops at the, through the hoops at the local level. All right, so I guess this isn't the last time we'll see each other. Thanks for your time.
Thanks.
We thank you.
Okay. Add on here treasury report next. I talked to Don Pornell this morning, and he was supposed to put it in the box for us, and that didn't happen. And maybe Jim has it, but neither one is here, so we're just going to bypass that for now. Before we get to the committee reports, I see Drew is here, and let's bring it up to the board now, because I mentioned it earlier. Drew Kefaver, Elm Street, Newmarket, is put an application in to become a member of the Conservation Commission. And working with Drew before on other projects, I think most everybody knows him here, so I don't have to say too much there. But he'd be a great addition to the commission. And I believe what we do now is to kind of give our okay, and I forward that to the town council to, and they make the final decisions, because it's an appointed position to the, so if someone would make that motion to forward this to the town council for approval.
I could make that motion. I've known Drew for a long time and enjoyed working with you, and look forward to doing it again.
Same. Thank you, Fred.
Thanks.
Motion by Fred to accept. Anybody second?
I'll second.
Win.
That was a tie.
Yeah, win.
All in favor?
He took the last second.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Drew. Appreciate the interest, and must have been, was it me on my knees begging for help?
It's interest.
Great. I appreciate it very much, and I know you'll, the knowledge will be much appreciated here, really.
Question for Drew?
Sure.
Drew, how active is the Open Space Committee at this time? And have they, you know, what is the status of that? Is that going to be an open commission, or is there any talk about having it as a subcommittee or some other organization in town?
I'll start with
the
Drew Kiefaber, 50 Elm Street. The Open Space Commission most recently had a meeting on Monday night. We are currently having meetings quarterly, so that provides an indication of our level of activity, meaning that it's pretty low. We have a similar situation of, I believe we currently have 5 members on the commission, and we're supposed to have 9, so we too have a number of vacancies. It would probably make sense to at least initiate some level of discussion of trying to do something.
Could there be a merger, I mean, into the Conservation Commission? And
ultimately, I think that would be a town council decision. I mean, there's a town
council.
Would
there be interest in it with the members that you have now?
I don't know.
Our work is side by side. You know, a lot of our work is side by side, and our interests are the same, and I think we're all shooting for that same goal, so. What the commission thinks of doing that. I always, my thoughts are, the more input you get, the better the outcome.
I believe the same.
So.
The only thing I would say is that our income comes from the conversion of land. The land that's converted to developments and so forth, we benefit from that, right?
Yes.
So since they're an integral part of what happens when someone wants to convert their land from current use to whatever use, it almost seems like it would be conflictive to have open space and conservation together, but maybe not.
How are they involved with that? Oh, because you're saying the idea is that their focus is to conserve land.
Right.
Okay, but and what I'm hearing is that our focus might be on getting people to develop it so we get the money.
No, not
necessarily. I know you didn't mean that.
I don't think that's what he meant, but
I think they have two entirely different objectives. Theirs isn't necessarily conservation
natural resources. It's just strictly land. I think they ought to be by themselves. And we us by ourselves. But, I mean, there's other things to open space besides acquiring easements and so forth, right?
Not much. I mean, realistically...
Promoting open space.
Yes.
It could develop into something like that down the road.
Can you... Well,
I would...
Why was it set up to begin with?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the... I may not have the right phraseology, but I believe there's an ordinance that established the Open Space Commission. Within that, there's a mission statement. I don't have the words exactly, but basically the purpose is to work with interested landowners who are interested in conserving their land, trying to figure out a way to make a package that works for the landowner, works for the town, and then make a recommendation to the town council to pursue this conservation objective or this conservation project. We're strictly advisory. The town council can say, no thank you, we're not interested in that at any time, and we have to walk away at that point.
So is it because you don't, the funds have been expended that the Open Space Commission was originally established to administrate? Is that why it's become less and less in the forefront? I mean, certainly open space has not, the need for open space has not diminished.
Absolutely. I would.
That's why I'm saying down the road, this Open Space Committee could take on a whole new responsibility and new objectives as to just administrating that money, that bond, to gain open space, right?
I'm not sure I understand what you mean by.
Has the bond been expended?
Well, of the $2 million bond, approximately $1.5 million have been expended.
And is the other half million dedicated to the fields?
Recreation.
There was a significant component of the public that supported the original $2 million bond that had an interest in recreational field space.
Right.
That is an objective that has not yet been achieved. Now, again, getting back to the advisory component of it, we provide advice to the town council. But ultimately, the money is owned, you know, the bond fund is the town's, and therefore, the town council is responsible for administering it, if you will, or saying how it is allocated. So,
all I'm saying is that open space should be more than just, should have other objectives besides just that. Advising the town council as to how to spend this money.
But that's what it was created for.
I think I understand what you're saying, Wynn, and I don't agree or disagree per se.
Which is not the same as this committee.
I would agree.
But
I'm not, yeah.
But I'm thinking, Wynn, that one of our objections is, as we've been talking about, like the trails and the connectivity of trails and the connectivity of open spaces and conservation land, that maybe they're really, I'm not going to say so much a mutual interest, but that the people who are involved with the commission have mutual objectives. And given that we're really people resource limited, does it make sense to somehow, like we're doing with the tree committee, have, and I'm not going to call it an open, I could call it an open space committee under the conservation commission, to try to expand the implementation of our objectives So if they're out there to talk to landowners about, you know, doing easements so that we can connect the trail systems or connect, you know, some conservation land to other conservation land. And then also potentially assist with monitoring the easements and land that we have.
Yeah, but would Open Space agree to become a committee of conservation?
That's why I was bringing it up. I don't know the status of Open Space. If they, what I'd hate to see is that that commission goes away because
right.
they're no longer needed.
Right.
But yet
but they
we
are
have
still
these
needed.
Really
That's
good
my point.
Resources, you know, people resources that, and as you're saying, things that do need to get done.
Right.
But does it have to be under a commission? Under a separate commission, where they have to find nine members, or have, you know, they can't have a meeting.
Or like struggle to find
like
nine
we
members.
We couldn't have last week.
Really?
Last time, we didn't have members.
Right.
We are two.
Okay. There's two of us, right?
Exactly.
Well, my thoughts when we talked were that some of their goals and our goals are the same.
Yep.
And if they would go into a hibernation mode, we could use their input here. When the need arises that, hey, who knows what happens down the road. If they do another bond or the town does another bond, they may need to activate the Open Space Committee again to search out properties. Correct?
Yeah, I mean, part of the reason that we're, you know, meeting quarterly is that we don't have any active projects currently. So, you know, we could get together every month, but it'd be a pretty short meeting. And so we decided, well, let's not do that. Let's meet quarterly. We can meet more frequently when when the need arises.
And
but
and
currently the need
isn't
there.
Nobody says we have to merge. I mean, I think that was just one of the thoughts there.
What's the likelihood that
they are?
Okay.
Well, I think they have a.
They have a mission.
They have a function.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Fred?
What do you think the likelihood is of a secondary bond being formed?
I have no idea. Me personally, I would have a tough time coming before the public to say that I think it's worth having another bond until we have expended the current bond mm-hmm. and can demonstrate that it was expended wisely.
So you got a $500,000 left to go.
So yeah, I mean, from my perspective, there's still $500,000 plus or minus a little bit in the open space bond, and
okay.
there's still an unfulfilled need that was clearly expressed when that bond was passed.
Has Open Space made any recommendation to the council about how you guys feel they should spend this money to facilitate recreation land? I mean, playing fields and so forth? Or has it just been left up to them, or to the school board, or to whoever?
A number of years back, one of the town councils a number of years back, when there was an effort by the school board to acquire property within town for a school site,
right.
the town council, I'll say, saw fit to indicate that it would be appropriate for $500,000 to be expended to help acquire land for a school site
mm-hmm.
with the idea that as part of that school site there would also be athletic fields that would be available for public use when they're not used for school use. For example, you know, the Leo Landrock fields behind the high school are used by the schools when when school is in session and immediately after school for, you know, baseball team practice, softball team practice, et cetera. However, on the weekends, it's, you know, it's available for public use as appropriate. You know, the Women's Softball League, the Men's Softball League, Babe Ruth Baseball, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So from a public efficiency point of view, at least in my mind, I think it makes a lot of sense to have additional recreation field space associated with a new school facility, if such a school facility is going to exist. So far, the voters of Newmarket have not voted for that, and therefore it hasn't happened.
Okay. Well, Drew, the next meeting is July 9th, so.
Sounds good. I'll make notes.
I'll get this. I'll bring this in Monday morning. The application.
Great. I look forward to serving with
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Likewise. Welcome.
Committee reports. Dal, it's going to seem redundant, but I know the planning board met on the one project that comes to my mind really quick. So,
planning board met on that, on the Hickory Pond subdivision project that was approved at Tuesday night's meeting. The first application was the special use permit that we had commented on. The planning board did approve the special use permit with the condition that the comments that we made were incorporated into that approval. They also add an additional condition relative to the application of pesticides in the deed-restricted areas, and that any pesticides to be applied in those areas would have to be done so by a New Hampshire licensed applicator. So they basically, they expanded our recommendations.
We mentioned fertilizers and
herbicides,
and someone, did you bring that up at the meeting, or pesticides,
no.
Or was that... George, right?
George did. So that, I think that was a good addition. The relative to the subdivision application, that was had an approval with, help me out here, Erica, maybe two pages of conditions.
Oh, that was a lot.
And most of those were related to engineering issues relative to the roads and drainage issues and things of that nature, and then technical issues of information that would be added to the plans. So that application at this point in time is completely through the planning board. The second formal application was for the mill redevelopment downtown, and relative to the conservation issues there, the town will be submitting to DES an urban exemption to the Shoreland Act. That is a portion in the act which would allow your municipality to exempt certain areas of the town, urban areas, downtown areas, from the act for development purposes. Otherwise, if, you know, for instance, if the mill redevelopment was subject to the Shoreland Protection Act, it probably wouldn't be redeveloped.
Or because of the closeness of the
water. Correct.
They still have to go by the rules of work ethics, right? I mean, ethics. The way the work is done around the wetlands still has to be protected, though. I mean, they don't get
Correct.
Away with that.
They're really exempt from the act itself, specifically issues such as, you know, no buildings within 50 feet of the waterfront.
How about demolition? I mean, they talked about a little bit of demolition.
The
of pots, or I don't know if they're L's to the building, but
small appendages to the building would potentially be demolished. But the market doesn't have a demolition ordinance.
Okay, but how about, does that matter, the closeness to the river?
I'm sure everything matters.
Right.
I don't know if you're asking the question, what requires a permit?
Well, are they by doing that? Are they signing away rights?
No, it's because we have our own Shoreland Protection Act, and then we have our own subdivision regulations or site plan regulations relative to issues impacting waterfront and buffers. The exemption basically allows the redevelopment of areas within an urban center without having to go through the DES shoreland applications. It's a waiver to those. Because in all instances, you would have no urban redevelopment if they had to, you know, abide by the Shoreland Act.
Oh, sure.
So, as part of that process, the planning board will be identifying and deliberating on what properties would fall into that overlay district. And we haven't even started those discussions, but it would be an identification of all the properties that the planning board, and because there would be public input on this, should be exempt. And that really brings up issues such as, you know, where the Riverwalk will go, because those properties should be exempt. Hmm. Where we want urban infill within the shoreland zone, things of that nature. I think those are the major issues that were brought before the planning board. And other than the water resource chapter, the presentation was given at our prior meeting. And we will be taking that up again at a workshop in July.
Okay, great. I think
that was it on the planning board.
Okay, great. I think that's pretty much the only committees we got going. The tree committee members are...
Well, I'll comment on that because that became, I'm sorry.
Oh, you do have something for
I should
that,
have
right?
really mentioned that one. Well, okay. it was a late meeting.
Put on your other hat for tree committee.
Well, I'm not on the tree committee, but what came before the planning board was a proposed tree ordinance. And
is that the memo we have here?
It's unfortunate that Jim is not here this evening, but I will drop these documents off to them. So the planning board reviewed the proposed tree ordinance that was submitted to the town council, and I believe the town council forwarded it to the planning board for comments. So what I've handed out this evening is a cover memo from the town planner Diane Hardy relative to her conversations with the urban forester Mary Reynolds, who also reviewed the ordinance, and with legal. And also the draft ordinance that was submitted, and this is a marked up version, so you'll see the various comments and questions within the text that are in color. Might be the blue or red, depending what copy you have. So those are actually the comments from the planning board. The planning board voted to send this back to the Conservation Commission for rework, if you will, before it would come back to the board for a recommendation to the council.
Okay, so this is really the first time we've seen this on a conservation.
Mm. Well, in that case, I think we should
review this?
The same thing that the planning board did. Review the proposed ordinance, add additional comments, and then get those to Jim as well.
And then give them to the town council or the planning board?
Well, the planning board's request was to submit to the Conservation Commission, because the tree committee falls under the Conservation
right.
Commission, what our comments were for in a request for a rewrite and a resubmission. So what I don't know is, are we discussing that this just goes back to the tree committee, or that the Conservation Commission as a whole is going to provide input and then give it to the tree committee?
Well, I think we should read through this and make notes.
Definitely.
get together with Jim at the next meeting and then follow through with it. That's my idea.
I agree. I think that's a good way to do it.
So, should we do that right now, or do you want to do this as homework?
I'd prefer to do this homework. Because I think it's
way too much.
Pretty detailed.
Yeah, it's way too much right now.
To digest in a few minutes, I think.
Yeah, it deserves a little more attention.
Diane Hardy was also kind enough to give us the submit in her package to the commission the contact information for Mary Reynolds, who again is the urban forester working for the Department of Resources and Economic Development Division of Forests and Lands. And she's located in Concord, as well as information from the local government center on trees in the right of way.
Oh, you've got a lot more.
The actual state RSA relative to tree wardens and trees and roadside growth, and several other. Oh, actually, she gave us copies of that. So let me hand those out.
Trees have already been planted.
Those are trees for the Main Street redevelopment.
Actually,
are different than what?
I need to grab that back. This is actually the whole RSA. She just printed out each section as a page. So I would recommend having this whole package go to Jim, unless anyone else wants to review it first.
That sounds reasonable.
Well, that's Jim's baby.
So I'll drop that off.
The tree committee is I think the downtown was already set to go before this even started, so Jim wants to expand on that for other areas too.
He wants an ordinance to apply to the whole town.
Yeah, but couldn't he, after this has passed, be possibly in violation of one of those ordinances as to where they planted the trees and so forth?
Possibly.
That's a good point.
Look to me, after reading a few of those things, that I could see that that's possible.
But the town's not obligated to their own ordinances. Like the aquifer protection over the our gravel pits over the aquifer protection.
Right.
Right. So. All right. So that's homework. Then we can go through the changes that, our notes, and give them to Jim at the next meeting.
And Drew, I'll give you a copy as well here. Happen to have a spare.
Okay, so let me try to get through the chairman's mail here, and we still might make it now. Okay. I might want to just go through this. This is Walter Cheney, Moody Point. They've been going back and forth on that. DES has a little blurb on that. Just anybody interested, before I put it in the file, just make sure it stays together. Since Jim's not here, I'll bring it up. the trail committee, so to speak, we got together last week, and Tuesday we're going to do a little walk around the Loisel property to kind of map out the trails. Mm. There's six of us at the meeting, so I think we got the input we need, but if anybody has any suggestions, give me or Jim a call. Jim's really the head of that part of it.
just a point of discussion, we had the presentation by someone who specializes in laying out trails a few meetings back.
Yeah, I should look that up.
Did the committee give consideration for having a professional actually lay the trail out? Someone who is knowledgeable in
wetlands
issues and things of that nature?
I don't recall that either.
I don't recall that coming up. And at the meeting with Jim and the rest of the group, I think it was, Drew, you were there.
Yeah, can I speak
to that? You sure can. We're going to.
As part of the management plan for the Piscataquis River Loisel property, there was, I don't remember the woman's name, but there was someone who came out and walked the property. And so there is a draft trail layout for that property that we found in the management plan for that property. So the plan is to bring that.
That was set up when the property originally went in to.
Yeah, after the property was conserved, the management plan for the property was established, and as a part of that.
So someone with that level of expertise laid it out?
For that particular property, yes. Yes. But as a more general statement, it would probably be good to continue that.
Thoughts that, my thought was, volunteerism only goes so far, and if we want to get it done, we may have to expend some money and get it done. A few things were mentioned. Wood chips put down as a base for the walk-in area. Worst thing that happens, they break down and add to it, and I define that walking area. So the first meeting was a start, and people are interested. A few people that aren't on any boards now were interested, so that's always a good thing. So Jim will have more info to do on that, okay?
That's one.
Just an update on the Nature Conservancy. They're removal of the houses there and the land that they just received down on the bay.
Bayview Road? Yep.
Yes. I guess there was a little bit of a disagreement on some of the property between owners down there, but I think that's all been taken care of. And it's just, I think it will go in the file with that. If anybody's interested in reading their letter.
Yeah. Do you know what the dispute was about?
Distances.
I wasn't aware of that.
One piece of property was thought to be owned by.
Bruce, Kathy gave you copies that should be filed with the town clerk and one with the town council.
Instead of,
she gave you all three copies that came back from DES.
Oh, wonderful. I will make sure she gets those Monday. Fred, you know, I overlooked one thing here. Yeah.
What's that?
In the committees, and I stepped on you here, and I'm sorry about that. While I get a few things together, do you want to just do the inventory of the rain barrels? And
oh, yeah. Yep.
I wanted you to do that because you work so hard
You have
putting that out there.
You have everything that I was going to hand out here.
Oh, okay. So if you want to just do that while I straighten out a few things.
Yep.
That'd be great.
Let's see. To date, we brought in a little over $1,100. And in terms of what we have for composters, we ordered 40, we sold 13, so we have 27 on hand. And rain barrels, we ordered 13, which is the minimum amount you can order. Two have been sold, and 11 are on hand. and I've forgotten who it is, but tomorrow, one, somebody's picking up a rain barrel and I think a composter too. And that's not included in here because we don't have the check in yet. And the kitchen pails, we ordered 20 and we sold 8 and we have 12 remaining. And that's kind of a distillation. I have the names of everybody that bought, and it's not on here, but I've got their phone numbers and so forth in case anybody wants to double check with anybody. And that's just kind of the bottom line.
Okay. Did you mention the reorder?
No, I didn't. We
reordered. We need to take a vote on that.
Oh, we do.
Let's make it legal by doing it. Let's put it that way.
That's fine.
I don't think we do because the money we voted to expend, it was returned and it re-expended, but...
Yeah, it's better if we're safe,
though. I think if we do the... Yeah.
Yeah.
No. I don't want it to come back and bite you or me.
No objection.
Especially me.
Especially Fred, too.
So maybe we ought to do that right now.
Okay.
Quick explanation of what happened?
Well, we certainly needed to reorder. And
right.
I think, you know, those are probably going to sell pretty well. That's my thought.
The original order of rain barrels went right out. They sold out within a week or two.
Yep.
And I think I called to make sure that it was in everybody's agreement that we reorder, to re-expend that money that we did. I'm not being up on rules of that. I think it would be wise to make a motion that we expend the money for a second set of orders. And
so has the ordering already occurred?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So you want a motion for a confirmatory?
Just to confirm that it's okay with the commission, because people not being here for the last meeting and everything like
and
that.
And what was the amount?
What was the amount, Fred?
Let's see.
That's your...
This is to be filed. 13... That's about, it'd be about, I got 180, but I think it was more than that. That doesn't make sense. There's 13.
It was 13 at...
13 times 60.
$720.
That's more like it. Very good. Thanks for helping my arithmetic out.
I make a motion.
Yeah, that's...
I make a motion to confirm the expenditure of
$720
on the purchase of rain barrels.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. I should.
Did you like another one?
they sold out so quick, and then Fred was going. I got people calling me, and two more were sold since then. Correct.
Yep.
So we have some inventory, but they're available now that we have some. So that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we got the paperwork out of. Thank you for taking that.
Mm-hmm.
More bookwork, paperwork for the test wells, the pezometers, more work for DES, just stating that.
What is a pezometer? Is it like a pedometer?
Pezometer? Does that sound like a pezometer? It's when they do the drawdown on these test wells.
Oh, okay.
To put in these little 1-3/4 pipes, they had to get DES permission to test them. And it's just more bookwork that has to be filed with that. Mm-hmm. So if you're interested, I'm going to leave it right here.
A lot of paper going back and forth tonight.
Again, more paperwork to be filed. This is the Nature Conservancy on the Bayview Drive more paperwork because of that little dispute on that small piece of property that they seem to have it all taken care of. But I'm sure this should be filed with that application. Interested parties can take those and read them.
You know, I should just mention one thing. I have it before me here, a receipt. And this is a receipt from the town of Newmarket Finance Department that says, indeed, we delivered $1,144 to them. And I think we're around $300 more now. But just for the paper and people looking at things with a jaundiced eye, maybe, we thought we'd have a paper trail for it.
It's a good idea.
Okay, now, this requires us to look at this. First, application for minimum impact agricultural projects. Now, where Sergio had, this is different than what Sergio did, I believe, but it's almost the same scope of work. So, I'm going to go over it. Paul Rosa with Wayne Rosa are acting as the contractor, I guess, and Paul being the owner of the property. They want to repair a culvert on the farm property. I was going to ask for help on this through Ed as far as signing off on this. They're going to take out an old stone culvert and install, you know, the plastic corrugated. And it's the scope of the work. It's pretty detailed on how they're going to protect that area and grade it off and use the grasses and things to filter the runoff from the, if water goes through that culvert, you know, depending on the water table at the time. If you want to just look through that. This is another part of that. This is why I asked about Sergio too. It has a maintenance worksheet for that area. It's pretty in depth. I mean, of what kind of grass seed to use, what type of fertilizers, and they have. I took half an hour the other day and read through this.
This goes with this.
Well, it's another step to that. That's the culvert.
A lot of paper tonight.
Yeah, it's.
Is it an agricultural drainage ditch?
Yeah.
And so they're restoring it.
They're restoring it.
This is being done on private land.
Yeah.
It's a wetland.
But it's a wetland.
Everything's a wetland.
Yeah. Especially when you call it, you know, a culvert. They had to do a lot of studies that a developer would have to do for a subdivision in that area. So, it's pretty in depth, and I'm sure it really took a lot of time to do it.
Really detailed.
Well, this is an expedited permit, so they're looking for a 30-day response from DES.
Right.
But they'll only get that if they get a positive
feedback from us.
From the conservation
commission. How can we do that from just that?
I think it falls into the same category that
we need time to.
Someone or some subcommittee needs to be reviewing these applications.
Right. Like I said, I went through the other day and read through these. I'm not an engineer, but they look pretty in depth.
It looks in depth, but there's no way I could give it justice in, you know, just a few minutes.
Right. And I think we have more time than that. My thinking is to piggyback this on top of Sergio's project. I think we ought to stagger it.
Well, why doesn't Fred take this when I deliver in 2 days or 3 days, whatever we work out, we'll just switch.
Okay, take this one?
That was my idea. Now, let's keep it all together, though, because there's a lot of it here.
Did it come as multiple applications, or is it all part of the same application?
It's pretty much all part of the same. One part is the culvert itself, and then the other part is the water, the
ditch.
I don't want to call it a swale, but it, yeah, I guess that's what you would call it. The runoff from that, and how it's going to be cut.
It is all that stuff, Fred.
It's all of that.
This?
And okay. This. And there's another map here. So if you could keep it all together.
Okay.
With a big clip.
Yeah.
If you want to put a sticky note on that and initial it when you're done.
Yep.
I've read it.
What was your impression?
That they're taking all the precautions as if it was a major piece of work. Right down to the type of grass that has to be planted, how deep they're going to go into the soil. And how deep they go into rototilling it to plant the new seed. And the distances are all mapped out there. Again, it seems like a lot of paperwork for a culvert, but you know, if you don't do it here, other projects will get by. I didn't see any problems with it myself. When it comes down to the numbers of elevations and things like that, you know, that's an engineer. But my interest was to make sure that the protections were in place.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all spelled out in there, so
okay.
To me it was, but I think we should all look at it.
When do you think you'd have yours done?
2 days. What's your schedule? 2 days? 3 days?
I would say it's going to take me a couple of days because tomorrow I'm out of pocket.
Okay. I'll get you this by Monday.
Okay. Yeah, let's trade Monday. Yeah, we'll definitely get it done by then. And then you're going to give it to George, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. That's pretty much what I had. Old and new business. Is anything? Val, could you fill us in on the fishing derby?
Fishing derby. Another great success. I don't have an exact number on the number of kids that were registered, but there had to be a couple hundred there at least. Jim made the award or recognition presentation to Richie before the awards were given out. He did a great job, and I think everybody saw the plaque.
Yeah.
And with the proclamation and then the fly box.
I apologize for not being there. Like I said,
the
graduation timing, my timing was off.
So
I had the wrong count, not wrong dates in my mind for that, so I couldn't make it. I wish I could have been there for him.
And the cost of that was significantly under the allocated budget. So.
Oh.
Val, do you? Oh, okay. That's what I was going to ask you.
So I think, you know, not obviously at this meeting, but at some point in the future, we might want to consider a discussion of, again, a subcommittee under the Conservation Commission that would be the Fishing Derby Committee, and bring in other people like they're doing with the Trail Committee that aren't necessarily mm-hmm. commission members. but maybe there's one designee from the commission that serves on the committee. Just to, you know, it would be a shame for it to have that event, you know, not continue.
For sure.
Val, you had paid these yourself, correct?
Correct.
So, check will be made out to you. Any new business that wants to be brought up?
You know, there is one thing, and I'm going to have to find it, but Pauline actually bought the rain barrels on her credit card, so she needs to be reimbursed for that. I've got it here somewhere, and if I don't dig it up, I'll...
I brought these just for that reason, Jim.
What is that?
Requests for...
Oh, okay.
I thought between you and Val already had hers made out. I wish I had thought I'd given you this earlier, but there it is.
Okay.
If you want to fill that out, I'll bring it into the... to the town administrator to get that signed off on, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You just want to put any invoices with that.
Okay.
Okay.
And then, as new business, I guess, and maybe we talked about this before, I wouldn't have gone ahead and done this, I don't think. We looked into getting shirts and hats. I think all of us have one, right?
But maybe Val doesn't. We need to...
Oh, you know. Oh. Well, Pauline actually got the quotes for three shirts, maybe $25. And for three... shirt, natural size, medium. Oh, I see. She's got two here, medium and large. And that would be $50.
Three shirts, $50?
Six shirts.
Six shirts.
And caps are six. Six of them, $18.
It's not $18 a piece, or is that $18 for six caps?
You know, I think that's... It could be per cap, couldn't it?
That'd be an expensive cap, but
Steve.
Hmm. Yeah.
Well, let me double check on that, because that's a good point.
And check on the shirts too.
Yeah.
If that's each.
I will do that. Right.
That sounds a little steep for shirts. That could be for all six. But that would seem awful cheap.
Yeah, it
with
would
an embroidered
seem
hat.
Awful cheap. For sure.
So
there's something wrong with a quote here, because...
Is that a reorder from the prior vendor?
This was the prior vendor, right?
It would be nice if we could have them for Heritage Weekend. That way...
Oh, I think they easily have them.
Yeah.
Yep. No, I will double-check on this quotation. Right here.
Okay.
Anne got them before, didn't she?
Sorry?
Roseanne Wax got them before, didn't she?
I think she did get them before, yeah.
Right. So where did that quote, that statement come from? Same
well,
company?
The same vendor.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
So there'll be no change. They'll be exactly the same as the ones we have now?
Yeah, that's my understanding.
And that could be why they're less money, too, because we probably had to pay a setup fee for the embroidering and stuff like that.
Good point. Yeah. Yep, I'll bet they have that.
That might be already in there, so.
Mm-hmm.
But if you could just confirm and those prices. Is that something the commission would like to do, is to restock that for new members?
Yeah.
I'm sure Jim doesn't have one, and I know Val doesn't. I think the ones left in there...
Andrew might not have one.
Andrew probably doesn't have one, so. And I think we have one large one up there, and I think it would probably just come down over and look funny on everybody.
Yeah, that would be half of them right there.
Any new business from anyone else? Val?
I wonder if it's worth starting discussions among the commission on perhaps sending out a request for proposals to firms who would assist us in our monitoring and stewardship requirements of our conservation lands and easements to deal with the reporting mechanisms of them.
That would take a burden off the commission.
Well, I'm not, do we really have as a commission, the current members on the commission, do we have the expertise to actually draft those reports? I think Ellen had been doing it right along.
Right.
Yeah, she had.
You know, she might be somebody that would want to enlist in that effort.
Well, I would certainly recommend that her company be put on the list.
Mm-hmm.
For
mm-hmm.
competitive bidding.
Excuse my ignorance. What's the name of her company?
It's
Ibis.
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 White Ibis something. Consulting.
Yeah. I have her card, I think, at home. Or in my mess here. Propose.
Yeah, it should be a definite positive. Drew, can you think of anyone else?
I don't know for sure, but you might want to check with the local land trusts.
Yeah.
Good idea.
Check with
you know, I know that they have some level of stewardship activity.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if any of them contract those services out, so to speak. But it might.
That's a great idea.
You were
yep.
asking.
Yeah.
Because they would have those people on staff, right?
Right. Well, maybe.
Maybe.
But they might need that income.
So Brian Hart would be a major contact in your mind?
Sure. But I wouldn't. I'm sure there's others as well.
Okay, that's a good start. And we can build off it from there. There's two we can build off. I mean, if the Nature Conservancy may have ideas on who to get in touch with, too.
You want me to inquire with Dwayne Hyde? He's a couple of minutes away from my house.
In fact, if you want to call Ellen and Brian and wait.
Okay.
Get their input and see if they're interested. And whoever, Dwayne, whoever they use, maybe you can get in contact with them.
Okay.
And
our sitewalks will start in the fall, won't they? Monitoring?
We
did Nostrum Farm in December.
Right.
That's twice I did it with Ellen. At that time of year.
The Wigan Farms we did.
And I joined you on the
Nostrum.
That was Nostrum?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there another one down Dame Road that we do?
No, there's Schneer.
Okay.
Loisel.
And the new Smith easement, we'll have to pick that up?
No, I don't think we need to do that one. That's the Autobahn, right?
Oh, I thought
Autobahn
was holding
take
the. Aren't we holding the easement? I haven't.
I
we should look into that. I think Autobahn was going to end up with the fee simple title.
Yeah, but the majority of it's in Durham. I don't think.
I think we have the easement.
You do?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if we have the easement or if we're the secondary easement.
Okay.
I think we're the secondary. I don't think we're top dogging.
Just like the Quark property.
So we have Wigan, Loisel,
Schneer, and
Nostrum.
Yep.
I think those are the Tuttle Swamp, I think, is taken care of all by its fishing game
in it.
Yep. I believe. But you know what? That would probably get them done on time. Okay, number 10, what I've been really... election of offices. We were supposed to do this last meeting, but there was no last meeting. So,
very well do it now either, can you?
Well, I don't know. Jim's not here. He could end up with a bunch of offices.
We can even keep some offices open for future appointments.
Yeah.
It's both.
But we need to do it, and we need to get a list into the town. We can do business tonight, so my thought is to get it done.
I nominate Bruce Vecto chairman.
Second.
Oh, boy.
Or were you wanting to step up there?
No, I'm perfectly happy.
Thanks. Okay. Did somebody first that and second it already?
Yes.
I think Erica has it.
I think Erica has that. Are there anybody, any other nominations? All in favor?
Aye.
We need a vice chair because we've been doing this without one for a few months now since Ellen had to resign, so.
I think you should nominate Val.
I agree.
You know, that was my thought, and I'll tell you one thing. I'll ask you one thing. I'll ask because I'm not sure that Val can because she is a planning board liaison and
so
not.
What?
I'm asking. That's why I'm asking.
We all could be on one board or the other.
Yeah, I wouldn't think that would be a conflict, would you?
I have no idea what the town policies are. I mean, I'm an appointee.
You're an appointee
to the commission. Mm-hmm. So evidently, the way the commission is made up is I'm the planning board appointee to the commission.
You're a commission member.
Mm.
Well, I am a commission member, but I'm the planning board appointee.
So what? Nobody voted.
Yeah.
So it's everybody would. Nobody has any disagreements with it. Nobody has a problem with it. So to me, that means there shouldn't be a problem anywhere. If somebody wants to complain about it, show up.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
I'll second that nomination.
Good.
That when made.
Well, and Jim's the treasurer, so he would have, and he's a town council appointee.
Yeah. So what you're saying is you never had to go through the application
correct
format as Keith does?
Right.
Wow. I can't see his head. How can that be a big deal?
To me, it's not.
If they had the confidence to put her in here, then we certainly shouldn't
exactly
have a problem with it. Oh, I am.
When did you re-up? You've re-upped.
When am I out? May next year? No, I haven't re-upped.
Just want to, if you have a chance, could you just check that out, make sure.
Yep.
Okay, before us is Vice Chair. Val's been nominated. I second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Sorry, Val.
You got condolences already.
What did we work?
The Treasurer. I'm going to nominate Jim Bergeron to keep his post.
Agree.
I'll teach him not to show up for a meeting. all in favor?
Aye.
I think that pretty much covers us. I will get these and... That's why Drew waited an extra meeting.
Yeah, so we wouldn't get nailed, huh?
Okay.
There's no malice of foresight there.
Okay.
It has worked out well.
It did. That pretty much takes care of all the business that we had on the agenda. So I do have one item, and it's not new public as stated in the agenda, but non-public.
We're going to go into non-public if someone would make that motion.
So moved. I've been wondering all night what new public is.
non-public. At...
Good night.
Thank you, Drew.
Good night.
You're welcome. He just...